Glory in the highest heaven, to the Father and the Son and the Spirit He has given. Hallowed be the three in one.
Thanks, Mark. Good morning. I'm going to just move this. Before. I don't want to trip on it. I'll invite you to turn in your Bibles. We're not going to necessarily stay in any one passage this morning. We won't be in Revelation this morning. But I'll invite you to turn to Ephesians chapter 3, because I am going to read just a portion of that chapter this morning as we begin. So as you turn there, I do want to say, happy birthday to Adam. And yes, I am nervous every time Adam gets behind the mic. And I forget that until he gets up and takes the mic, and then I'm like, what did I do? But no, that's okay. Adam is, Adam, for those of you who don't know or haven't realized, Adam and me are two, we're on extremes of the spectrum here. Adam is everything I'm not, and I pick up for where Adam lacks, but I just want to let you know that you are valued and cherished, and I love that you're part of this team, and I think that you are an awesome youth pastor, and so happy birthday, and yeah. I'll invite you to stand to your feet for the reading of the Lord's Word this morning, and I'm going to read verses 14 to 21, and it's a prayer of Paul's. Paul is praying for the Christians in Ephesus, and he prays that they would be strengthened in their faith, and that their eyes would be set on Christ, and that they would know his love, and the end of this prayer, the reason he's praying this for them is so that they would be, that they would worship, that these things would result in them worshiping the Lord. And so let's read together. Paul says, "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. That you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." You can be seated. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you for this prayer of Paul's that reminds us of who you are, and that you've given us your Holy Spirit to dwell within us, and that your love is so great for us, it's unfathomable, and we could spend a lifetime learning about it, how deep it is, how wide it is. And Lord, all of this, may it erupt in our hearts in worship. Lord, that we would bow down before you and give you all of our praise and honor and glory, because you are worthy of it all. And so, Lord, I pray this morning, whatever comes out of this morning's message, that it would be to the end that we would long to bow down and worship you, that that would be the great desire and joy of our heart, Lord, to do that. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. "Why did you steal my gods? Why did you steal my gods?" This was Laban's question to Jacob after Jacob, after many years, was taking Rachel and Leah and his family and moving away from Laban. And Rachel, unbeknownst to Jacob, had in secret taken her father's gods, her family's idols, and taken them with her. And now Laban had caught up, and this is the question he asked Jacob. Why did you steal my gods? Now, as to why Rachel did this, there's no real clear explanation is given in that text. It comes out of Genesis 31. But I think it would be safe to assume that Rachel, moving away from her family, wanted to take her family's religion with her. Right? These are the gods that she worshipped growing up. These are the gods that she knew. Her heart, growing up in that house, and the worship that was given those gods, her heart had been trained and shaped to love them. These gods, false as they were, shaped her outlook on life. And she no doubt found comfort in them. There was stability with them. And so she took them. And I find it fascinating. And I think that small little story for us captures to us the small truth of the profound impact that worship has in the home, especially on our children. Right? The worship Rachel has been raised with in her home profoundly impacted her. She took it with her. And every day in our houses, worship takes place. I would argue that every day in every house in this world, worship takes place. It's unlikely that any of us here or many of us in North America have carved images like Laban, but that's okay because some people wake up and they look at their God every morning in the mirror. Some serve money, some live for and serve work or vacation. Of course, many of us here sitting here, we would worship the true and living God. But all of us worship something. And the question is, what are you worshiping or who are you worshiping 6 days of the week? What's shaping our hearts? And for those of us who have kids, when our kids leave home, what worship will have trained and shaped their hearts? What God will they take with them when they leave the home? Now, to some of us, this will all sound odd, because for some of us, we have an understanding that worship is what takes place on Sunday morning at church. And yet the scripture has so much more of a robust idea of what worship is and where it is to happen. Worship, if I could just kind of give you a way to think about worship, worship is the heart responding appropriately when it encounters God and his works. Worship is the heart responding appropriately when it encounters God and his works. So that means worship will take place sometimes in a very, we've set time aside, we are considering the Lord, and we are worshiping him very intentionally. Other times, worship is going to happen spontaneously throughout the day because we encounter God's works. Which one of us doesn't wake up on a beautiful sunny morning, look at the all of the mountains around us, and whose heart isn't praising the Lord, right? That's worship. And that's a proper response to that, to God's creation. Now, we have been encountering the theme of spiritual battle as we have been making our way through different portions of Revelation. And that spiritual battle, we have learned, is to be fought through worship. Believing in, following, praising, obeying, rejoicing, and loving the Lord God Almighty. And we see that worship displayed marvelously in Revelation chapter 4 and 5, and Richard read a bit of chapter 5 this morning, where myriads upon myriads are bowing down before the throne. This is the apex of all of creation, of all of history, is when this happens, when all of heaven and all of earth bow down and worship before the throne. And Jesus has told us that we are to be about the task of creating worshipers who will be there bowing down before that throne, right? He said to us, go into all the nations and preach the good news, baptize people, teach them all that I have commanded you. You could hear that this way, go and make worshipers. Go and make worshipers who will be around that throne, who will willingly bow down and praise the Lord. And this whole process of making worshipers is to begin in our homes. It's to begin in our homes with our families. And the whole idea of this worship, or some have called it, you know, family worship, for some reason has fallen out of fashion for some of us. You know, for a large part of us, it's kind of this optional thing we think about doing, or maybe we don't ever consider. We treat it like maybe it might be a suggestion for us. But I would submit to you that it's actually not a suggestion. It's not a suggestion. As we read the scripture, it's simply assumed that this will be taking place in our homes. That this will happen. That out of a full heart of love for God, we would worship together with those that we love the most. But you know what? It's a very, very strange thing. And I don't know about you, but it makes me sad that for some of us, this has become incredibly awkward or strange. That in our own homes, bowing down with our spouse or our children, and I get some of you can't, you have an unbelieving spouse or an unbelieving, that's a different thing, but for those of you who are able, you are two believing people, and perhaps you have kids, it is a sad thing when it becomes awkward or strange to bow down and pray with each other or to worship with each other. And so it often goes neglected. You know, Paul describes how worship naturally flows out of those who love the Lord. He says, let the message of Christ, let the gospel, right, that good news, that blessed news, dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, with psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude, with thanksgiving in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word, whether you're speaking it, or whether you're doing it with your hands, word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That's out of Colossians, and Paul is talking about households. It's a beautiful, it should be a natural response. It's a Spirit-filled, God-ordained, exalting thing when a family who God has put together worships together. When they read the Word together. When they give thanks together. When they pray for each other, for the needs that one another has. Scripture assumes that this will be going on. Scripture assumes that those who love the Lord will worship him this way. And in case it was unclear, we're also instructed to do it. We all know the passage in Deuteronomy chapter 6. We've read it here many, many times. That famous instruction given to Israel to all those who would come to faith in the Lord. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand. They shall be like frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and your gates. Worship him in everything you do. And whenever you have an opportunity, speak of him. With your kids, when you're out camping, whatever it is, there's always an opportunity to praise the Lord, to shape their hearts, to turn their eyes to him. This is what this is instructing us to do. And it should be a joy, shouldn't it? Should be a joy for us. To take our children, or even to be with our spouse, and to turn their eyes to the Lord, to remind them of how great and awesome and beautiful and majestic and grace-filled and merciful our Lord is. Paul says to us, be the aroma of Christ. Right, our houses, and I think about that, and our houses are to be full of the aroma of Christ. Full of love and joy and peace and the Holy Spirit. Not that our households are free from problems or all kinds of distractions or whatever, but they should be places where worship takes place, and so the aroma of Christ is there even in the midst of all of the problems and all the difficulties or whatever. You know, whether we're, and this can take place whether you're single, you're living alone. I mean, there's always an opportunity to invite someone in and to share that with you. It should be a discipline that you're practicing for young marrieds. You worship together, and of course, for families. And even empty nesters, those who have kids who have moved away. All of us should be practicing this. And not because we have to. But because we get to, because we desire to. Right? How can we pass through a single day and not consider the Lord? And you're probably thinking, why am I going on about this? Why am I talking about this? Well, let me share with you. The reason is, as you know, I think it was maybe two weeks ago now. Your elders met, and we met for a time of, it had come to be known as an elders retreat to plan 5 to 10 years. And I'll just share with you that as we met on the Friday evening, and we prayed, we were talking, and the first thing that became very apparent was this isn't a retreat. Right, we were in the church basement, no one was relaxing, and it wasn't really this time of great rejuvenation. So I just want to take, if that's in your mind that we went on a retreat, let's just push that to aside. And what really happened was your elders got together for a planning session over a weekend. And there was a 5 to 10 year kind of number that was thrown out. And as we talked about, we sat around the table together and we were talking, We felt that this was not something we wanted. What we were going to discuss and perhaps what came out of our meeting, we didn't want to have time constraints on that, any artificial time constraints or anything. And we just felt that it was more appropriate to leave that open, to see what came out of this and then perhaps work with the timeline. And you know, part of that came about because as we reflected on the past 4 months, who would have imagined we would be now here now with masks on, you know, doing what we're doing. It just, the whole world drastically changed. And so I just wanted to clarify those things. And so we as we gathered on Friday night, we sat and we began with prayer. We read Scripture, and specifically we were reading Revelation 4 and 5. And as we discussed, the approach that we wanted to take also was, you know, we could come to the table and put all of our ideas on the table and then be consumed with talking about those things for the next weekend. But what we decided to do was just to simply ask the question, what has the Lord told us to be doing in His Word? And where are we not strong in that area? And so that's how we approached the weekend. And like I said, we began by reading Revelation chapter 4 and 5, and it took us to that, again, that magnificent and overwhelming picture of our God seated on His throne and all of heaven and earth worshiping Him continually day and night. And I believe, and I think the elders would agree with you, with what I'm about to say too, I believe that that really set the stage for the weekend for us. It set the tone for the whole weekend. We have one who is on the throne, and we are to worship Him. And our great goal is to make people who worship Him. And so we didn't solve all the church's problems. We didn't even address all the church's problems, right? Challenges or things or every ministry. We didn't get anywhere near that far. But what did become clear for us was that worship and making worshipers, people who long to worship the one who sits on the throne, is absolutely central. And if we're weak in any area of that, then we need to pay attention and strengthen it. And that's where we need to begin. And so all the things that we discussed, and I'm going to try to share with you this morning kind of the things and what we plan on doing, all of the things that we discussed, I think you can put in two categories, worship in the home and worship in church. Some of the things that we're going to suggest and some of the changes that might be made, and really they're not huge. And so I've already shown how worship in our home is kind of this biblical expectation. And we believe that God has instructed us to be doing this. And some of us, like I said, some of us are doing this. And some are not. And we feel like the Lord would have us strengthen ourselves, our church family, in this area. That this is a place where we could use some strengthening. And our desire is to create a community here at TAC where worship in our homes with our spouses or our children, or if you're single, if you have meet with another person, where worship in our homes is absolutely normal. It's something that we as a church family do and something that we value. And so we want to foster this, we want to disciple people in this, and have it be part of who we are here at TAC. We want to see this as a joyful thing that we do, as a privilege as we do. And so in trying to foster and disciple that, what we want to do over the next, the foreseeable future is to have times when we, when there are classes or whatever on what family worship can look like at different stages, and try to help put tools in your hand, how to make those who have never done it feel comfortable doing it, and just how to get into that kind of thing. We also, we want to have things for husbands and wives specifically, and just to nurture each other in these roles and how we can grow in them. If we've been told to do this, then let's strengthen ourselves in it. And it's no secret that the world around us is growing, more and more adverse to our faith. You know, us and our kids are living in a world that challenges our faith continually. Why would we not want to foster an environment in our homes where we encourage each other through God's word, we pray for each other, we strengthen each other in these ways? And so we want to set our minds to do this in a more intentional way. We know that all of us have read the statistics, and we've shared them here before, of, you know, when we raise our kids up in the church or whatever, and then they go off to college, there's a good majority of them fall away from the faith, right? Or when they grow to a certain age, this tends to happen, and the question is why? What can we be doing? What is a remedy to this, if there is a singular remedy? Well, those of you who are of a certain vintage here will remember the California raisins. Does anyone remember the California raisins? Dave's nodding his head. Yeah, Aaron. Anyone else? Yeah, of course. So in 1980, man, that's a long time ago now. Jared, you're an old man. In 1980, the California Raisin Marketing Board approved an advertising plan, right? And it involved these advertisements that had these claymation raisins, and their thing was they sang soul music, right? And in today's terms, we would say that this went viral. It was, by all measures, the ad campaign was wildly successful, right? These claymation raisins released 4 music albums, okay? One of their songs was on the Billboard Top 100. They were nominated for an Emmy Award. They had a Saturday morning cartoon, and they had a toy line. These things just went crazy. They sold over $200 million in merchandise. That's pretty successful. But it's not. Raisin sales went down. After all of that, raisin sales went down. The ads, the claymation characters were famous, you know, they did a lot of amazing things or whatever, but they did not produce people who ate raisins. You know, with all of the things that we have at our disposal, with all the Bible studies and the programs we have produced, the books, and we continue to produce them, with all we created, with Christian music and movies, with PureFlix and right now media, Bible studies at our fingertips online, and the list could go on, and don't hear me wrong, these are very, very, very good things. They're tools. But why, with all of this, does it still seem a struggle to produce worshipers who love the Lord their God and follow Him and don't fall away from their faith when they leave home? And it is a multifaceted answer to that question. But one of the points for sure is that far too many Christian families rely on the church for 2 hours a week to train our kids' minds and to shape their hearts. 2 hours of training their mind and shaping their hearts to love the Lord is completely insufficient. If we are not worshiping in our homes regularly with our children, then the world that they live in will have a much, much bigger influence on them. And there is nothing more powerful to strengthen our faith and form the faith of our children than worshiping in our homes. The impact that this has on our marriages and on our kids it, right? And I know that I'm drawing a lot on that on children, but I'm wanting you to know that spouses who don't have kids, and again, the single people, this should be something that we're practicing together, because when we do this in our home, it not only strengthens our faith and impacts our children, it strengthens our marriages, right? It does all kinds of things. Not to mention bringing joy into the house. And again, that's not to say that, you know, if we practice this and we do this, that everything in our homes is going to be hunky-dory and it's all going to be great. No, it's not. It's not even a guarantee that your kid won't depart from the faith when they grow up. There's no set formula that you can follow that's going to guarantee that, but I think we would have to agree that this will certainly go a long way in helping them form their faith, strengthen their faith, and grow in it. And for mom and dad to be an example to our children of doing this, there is no more powerful example for your children than when mom or dad is on their knees praying with them. Someone has said a great oak tree is not grown by occasional spectacular exposure to the elements, but by unspectacular, ongoing, daily exposure to the elements. The effects of regular family worship are not seen or felt in the moment, but years in the future, you see the fruit of it. And so we want to be at the job of training our hearts, training our minds and shaping our hearts to worship. And again, this is a powerful thing when it happens in our home. I recently read a testimony of a man who wrote about his parents' 50th wedding anniversary. And all five of their children decided to share one thing about their parents that they were thankful for. And let's just all share one thing. They didn't get together and talk about it. Everyone kind of had their own thing and no one knew what the other one was going to say. And all five of their children thanked their mother for her prayers and their father for leading them in family worship. One of the brothers said, "Dad, the oldest memory I have is of tears streaming down your face as you taught us how the Holy Spirit leads believers." At that young age, and he thinks he was about, 4 or 5 years old, he said that God used you as you worshiped, and as we worshiped as a family, to convict me and convince me that Christianity was real. It's a powerful thing. And we've just come through a time and we've seen, and we're still in the midst of this pandemic, and the world changes so quickly now. We've seen how quickly church can just shut down. But that can never happen in our homes. That can never happen in our homes. And if church ever shuts down here, we should be well acquainted with and prepared to just carry on worshiping in our houses. And so this was something that was impressed upon our hearts. And this is a focus. We want to focus on strengthening this, and we will put our effort into doing that as a church family, developing this, encouraging this. We want it to be something that Trail Lines Church does, what we value, what we see as a really, really integral part of the Great Commission. It is part of the Great Commission. Did the lighting just change? No? Oh, maybe it got dark outside. Sorry. Random train of thought. And so in order to do that, like I said, we want to provide, we want to do just some, you know, to get together, classes together, talk about how we can do this, how, what works, you know, discover what works good for other people, some tips and hints of how we can do this together. Another thing that we're going to do is we're going to develop a Trail Alliance Church family worship guide. Something just really simple that will take a family through 52 weeks of worship together in the home. And not only that, what we want to do is in light of that, we want to reevaluate all of the children's curriculum downstairs. Everything that we've been using, we're going to spend time reevaluating. And what we want to do is we want to have it dovetail this Trail Alliance Church Family Worship Guide so that the children, when what they're learning in Sunday school will be the same thing that families can focus on for their worship time. And for those who don't have children, it's just kind of the whole church would just be on the same kind of stream throughout the year of worshiping together. And so that's one of the things that will come out of this. And this is not to be a burden to you. This is to be a joy. And this is not something that we're going to put and, you know, force you to do. We're not going to be coming into your homes at night, breaking down the doors and making sure that Dave has a copy of the Trail Alliance Church Family Worship Guide. And if he's not doing it, well, I don't know yet. No, this is to be a tool in your hands, hopefully, that will foster worship in our houses. And so this is one of the ways forward that we had. And that really is... in terms of, you know, worship in the homes, this is what we sense as the Lord would have us focus on and strengthen. And we want to do it intentionally. We really want to pour into this. And now there's things, worship in the church, and these things are just a little bit of, they're nothing major. We just want to make some small changes when we gather to do things a little bit differently, and some of them aren't even new. They've been done in the past here. We just want to do them again because they were good things that for some reason we haven't done. And so the first thing that we do want to do is, well, I've already actually talked about this, reevaluate all of the Sunday school curriculum and you know, get new stuff or whatever, get stuff that will work well with the direction we're going in. Second, I mentioned this before, we will have prayer available every Sunday starting in September. There will always be someone up here to pray with you. Prayer is so integral to worship, and you should never have to look around to find someone to pray for you. You should know where you can go and where your church family will pray for you. And so that will be a fixture there. And so there are, you know, and this involves you, church family. In order to make these things happen, we need participation from you. We need you to join the prayer team. One of the other things we're going to do, and this, again, might seem trite or whatever, but for years and years we've talked about a welcome center. We will have one by September. We're throwing up a Dutch door for a place where when newcomers come into the church, there will be a place where they can go and they can find out all the information they need. There will be a place so when someone's new here, you can say, hey, it was wonderful to meet you. Make sure you stop by there and you'll get a gift. We're going to have cups or whatever, just something that they can take with information so that they can get connected more easily. Another small but I think a good change is, you know, we one of the things we do as a church family and one of our most intimate times of worship together is when we celebrate the Lord's Supper. And if you've been here for a long time, you know that it's the me and an elder, and then the other elders line up and we serve communion to you. And that's good. There's nothing wrong with that. But we want to change things up for a season or so. We want to do something a little bit different. An elder and a pastor will preside over the meal, but we want you, the church family, to be part of serving it. We want you, the members, to line up here and help serve and serve it to your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. Again, nothing amazing or difficult to do, but we want to make these small changes. And one of the things that we talked about too, and we don't know, like we said, we don't know the future right now. Things are up in the air with COVID. There's restrictions on everything. One of the things that we are considering how we can do is moving into a season where we're not focused necessarily on small groups. Small groups are good, and many of you are involved in a small group, and we're by no means canceling any small groups. You know, we encourage small groups to keep gathering if they choose, but we think it would be beneficial in the future here to focus on some large group gatherings that perhaps all of the men, you know, fathers and sons, seniors, would gather once a week and worship and have a fellowship time together, or perhaps do, you know, some kind of hike together or something, but focus on a larger group setting. The same with the women, right? Mothers, daughters, grandmothers, or whatever, would all meet together. And we think that this would be beneficial for us as a church to build community, because what this will do, sometimes we get into our small groups or we come on Sunday mornings, but we never have a real opportunity to perhaps meet someone who we wouldn't regularly connect with in a small group. And so this would give an opportunity for us to just make connections, a bigger connection with our church family. And so that's some of the things. Now, there's one other thing. And by the way, we do invite all of your feedback to this. We would love to hear your feedback or suggestions, or if you think we're wildly off base and just losing it, let us know. We'll take that into consideration. One of the things that came up, obviously, as we thought about the future was the building next door, of course. And again, you know, we had gathered as a church family before the whole COVID thing struck, and we as a church membership had voted to, yes, go ahead and gather all the information, what it's going to cost and everything, and then come back and present that to us so that we can vote on whether we move ahead or purchase or not. That committee is working through the crisis. Things kind of got put on hold, but that is up and we'll be pursuing that. But as we thought about moving forward, and as we thought about what had been impressed upon our hearts with training our children's minds and their hearts and developing worshipers of Christ who will gather around that throne, what we talked about and came to was that we think it would be a worthy and a God-honoring investment if we were to purchase that building with a long-term goal that we would develop a Christian school that would go eventually, hopefully, from K to 12. A place where our children would be taught from a Christian worldview, right? With the goal to develop good and godly men and women who worship, who are strong members of the church and of society, and who impact this world for Jesus. And that investment, if we were to run with that vision, would serve generations. It would serve generations. And so, church family, those are the results of this weekend. And there, I understand that as you listen to this morning, there's quite a bit of things I threw out there. And there's a lot I didn't even touch on. There's a lot of different areas and ministries of the church that I didn't even get to. And we just couldn't cover in that weekend. So please don't think that there's nothing else that we'll focus on moving forward. But as we sought the Lord and as we prayed, this is what we believe He's laid on our hearts for this moment at Trail Lines Church. And so we want to pursue it, and we want to pursue it with you. Church family, we want to build a strong, solid community of people who are focused on the Lord, worshiping Him and making people who worship Him, disciples who worship Him. We want to be able with a psalmist, well, I hope we do. We want to be able with a psalmist to say we will not hide the works of the Lord from our children, but we will tell them to the coming generation. The glorious deeds of the Lord in His might and the wonders that He has done, that the next generation might know them. The children who are even yet unborn. And arise to tell them to their children, so that they would set their hope in God and not forget His works. Let's move towards that goal. Let's do that well. Let's strengthen each other in the areas that we've talked about today. And when our children leave home, may they take their great and awesome God, the God of the Scripture, with them, that they may be worshipers in spirit and truth, bearing witness in our world to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your love for us, for your grace and your mercy. Lord, we thank you that you care for each one of us and for our families. And Lord, as we set our eyes upon you, Lord, would our greatest desire be to worship you? And Lord, I pray that would be a great goal for our church, that we would gather to worship here. But Lord, that we would make our homes places of worship. Lord, that love for you would overflow into every facet of our life. And that worship of you outside of the walls of this place would be normal. And Lord, that would impact how we live, that it would impact our neighbors, that it would impact our world for the gospel of Christ. And so I pray that through the strength of the Holy Spirit, we would have a singular focus to love you, worship you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Keep us from being distracted, Lord. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
God, from whom all blessings flow, praise Him, O creatures here below, praise Him above the heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and